We use fossil fuels for energy because they pack a lot of punch in a very compact form. Imagine trying to push your heavy car a kilometer, 3,280 feet, to the gas station, when the same task can be accomplished with just 100 milliliters, less than half a cup, of gasoline. Unfortunately, gas-powered cars release a lot of CO2 in that process. Similarly, in a power plant burning natural gas, one of the cleanest burning fuels, it still releases 407 kilograms, or 898 pounds, of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere for every megawatt hour. Petroleum sources and coal are 234% and 246% worse, respectively. Switching to sustainable, environmentally friendly sources like wind, solar, tidal, and geothermal could eliminate all that. With portable batteries improving daily, our society is moving towards a more ubiquitous electrical future. Storing power from the sun and wind is problematic. Battery technology is advanced, of course, but those batteries wear out and need to be recycled and replaced. Not only is recycling costly, but is difficult as well, and uses a lot of energy and generates more CO2 to be released into the atmosphere. There is a much better way. Gravity batteries. What are those? Humans have been using natural gravity batteries since the beginning of human existence. Until we evolved intelligence, we didn't recognize that, of course. Gravity batteries are built into how our planet works. You've heard the expression, what goes up must come down. That holds true on any planetary body where an object doesn't exceed escape velocity. Technicalities aside, you know that here on Earth, if you place a rock in mid-air, it will accelerate towards the ground at 9.8 meters or 32 feet per second. Thanks to the sun, the weather cycle, and water in plentiful supply, water rises from low points by evaporation, deposits at high points by condensation and precipitation, and flows back to low points by gravity. This carves rivers, makes new geography, provides essential moisture for plants and animals, and transports chemicals and minerals, making life possible. Our whole weather system is a gravity battery, collecting mass from a low point, moving it to a high point, and then releasing it to do work and power our whole planet. And of course, it's entirely solar powered. In 1879, the first hydroelectric power generator opened at Niagara Falls on the Canadian-US border. At 57 meters or 187 feet tall, the Niagara River has a flow of 160,000 meters or 5 million feet per minute. That provides enough energy to power 25% of the electrical needs of Upper New York State and Southern Ontario on a continuous basis. For reference, that's 57 Olympic-sized swimming pools of water per minute. That's all well and good, since Niagara Falls seldom stops flowing day or night. That power is available rain or shine, light or dark, on demand. But that's not true with all renewable resources. Wind power is not continuous in most locations. Sporadic generation can mean that sometimes there isn't sufficient wind to generate enough power for local needs. If that was the only source, the local electrical grid would be in trouble. Some major errors have been made in building wind farms too. In China, at the largest wind farm in the world, with 7,000 turbines producing 93 gigawatts, they failed to consider that by turning the turbine blades, the wind was losing power. As a result of bad alignment, there are several generators that turn very slowly at certain times of the day because of weak, used-up winds. Similar to wind, but in much more dramatic fashion, photovoltaic solar panel power without external storage is only usable on sunny days for a limited number of hours. Problematically, the peak generation often occurs during off-peak usage periods, meaning generating capacity is sometimes wasted. Alternate solar technologies such as concentrated solar power, CSP, uses mirrors to superheat a substance such as molten salt or oils. These pass through heat exchangers to boil water into steam, driving a turbine generator to make electricity. The hot media can be stored, and used after the sunlight ceases, which makes it more convenient and useful. Still, a few cloudy days could put a real damper on that storage system, but even cold doesn't slow it down on clear days. Geothermal energy, GTE, is generated by the decay of radioactive elements far beneath the surface of our planet. Radioactives formed when neutron stars and black holes collided long before our own star formed, and then these elements drifted here, eventually making up a portion of our planet. A similar portion of GTE also comes from sunlight shining on the ground. So, except for radio geothermal, all of the energy we use comes from the sun. It's a result of direct solar insolation, radiated energy from our star, or something like petrochemicals and coal that were made using solar energy from previous epochs. Your local water tower is a gravity battery too. Water is pumped up to the highest point in town, and its mass pressure is used to move water throughout the community water system. This way, we don't need pumping stations all over town. We exploit the physics of pressure being equal within a closed hydraulic system. The energy is stored as gravitational potential energy, GPE, the what goes up scenario. Similarly, towns and cities in mountainous regions build reservoirs and pump water uphill when energy is plentiful and not required. The first one was built in Switzerland in 1907. When the need for power increases, they simply let the water flow back downhill to drive turbines, just like Niagara Falls. But the water movement is man-made, utilizing generation capacity that would otherwise go to waste. Flowing water is used to do work. It has powered grist mills and sawmills for centuries, but it's not very efficient, usually in the neighborhood of 75% or less. What if we had a markedly more efficient energy transfer system with much less waste? Well, we do. These are not the typical chemical reaction batteries we're used to thinking about, such as in cars or in your phone. It is a purely mechanical battery that is about 90% efficient. There are several models of gravity batteries, like the water model mentioned above, but that is limited by geography. No mountains means no storage. What about one that could work anywhere and doesn't require a massive investment in infrastructure? This is not a construction crane out of someone's nightmare. This proposed unit stores electricity by converting it into gravitational potential energy. Three carefully balanced armatures pick up multi-ton blocks and stack them until the entire central tower is surrounded in concrete. It uses unneeded electrical generation to lift the blocks into place, and they gain GPE. When power is required, the crane picks them up and then lowers them slowly back to the ground, turning generators that convert that potential energy back into useful electric power. The huge advantage to this system is that it is simple, with well-understood engineering requirements. It is nearly maintenance-free compared to other systems, and it can be fully automated to run without any human intervention. It is also easy to expand by increasing the height. It has a very small footprint on land, is ridiculously efficient, more than 90%, and can store enough energy to power a small town. Think of it like a giant's Jenga game. However, since the blocks are not physically connected, they can shuffle during an earthquake tested to 8.0 and remain safe and stable, so this tower isn't going to fall. Mines that have been worked out leave behind long vertical shafts. By suspending hundreds to multi-thousand ton weights in the shaft, energy can be stored by raising the weight to the top of the shaft and then released by lowering it again, turning generators. Depending on the weight's mass, lowering it just a meter or a yard could power a town for an hour. However, placing one is dependent on there being a used-up mine nearby. On the other hand, constructing a shaft deliberately could be considered. A solid block of stone, raised and lowered hydraulically, would be more efficient than water alone. A rock cylinder, 250 meters or 820 feet in diameter and 250 meters tall, could store 8 gigawatts of power, say about 6 trips in a time-traveling DeLorean. or enough to power 6 million average homes at 750,000 houses per gigawatt. In a shaft 1 kilometer tall, moving from top to bottom at 2 centimeters per second would take 14 hours. Multiple, smaller weights would be able to store more and operate for longer periods, while a single large weight could provide hundreds of megawatts in just seconds to balance power grids and meet sudden demands, it would only need to move centimeters or inches per second to do so. Right now, the timeline for achieving net positive fusion energy is somewhere in the 2030s. But that is simply attaining the goal. It may not be commercially viable for another couple of decades after that, or even a century. ITER, International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, involving 35 nations, is a cooperative fusion testbed in France, sitting on an area equivalent to 60 soccer fields. It is a single location, costing billions so far, weighing 23,000 tons, will require 150 million degree temperatures to achieve fusion, and is not designed to be a commercial producer. It's an experiment. A small company in the UK called Tokamak Energy, using a much simpler system, has achieved 100 million degrees, sufficient to trigger fusion in the smaller machine. Its cost totals $70 million to date instead of billions. You could put several of these on a soccer field. Could fusion, or many other similar projects, make gravity batteries irrelevant? Sure, in about 30 years or so, but we don't have 30 years to wait. We need to reach net zero carbon emission ASAP to have a chance to moderate or halt dangerous climate change. Energy without resource to fossil fuels is already possible. Norway obtains 98.4% of its energy that way, followed by Brazil, 84.1%, New Zealand, 80%, Sweden, 68.4%, and Canada, 67.7%. The last five of the top 10 are Colombia, 64.8, Venezuela, 60.9, Portugal, 59.7, Chile, 48.2, and Germany, 44.5. Sadly, the US sits at only 12.6% from renewables, less than half of Mexico's 26%. The energy sector is still strongly resisting change. Other than that old-school industry resistance, the two big practical problems have always been storage and delivery. Gravity batteries solve both problems because when we have a method to store energy effectively, green energy generation should climb right along with it. And these gravity batteries fit into just about any environment. Gravity batteries already have working models by many companies around the world. The demonstration unit by Energy Vault is just 60 meters high, but their basic 120 meter unit can store 20 megawatt hours, or enough energy for 2,000 homes for a day. Energy Vault's concrete blocks are 23 metric tons each. In terms of money and technology, it is simple to build and operate. Another advantage for gravity batteries is that they can store any electrical energy provided. If we happen to switch to orbiting geosynchronous solar power satellites that collect much more energetic solar radiation from well above the Earth's atmosphere and beam it down by microwave, then gravity batteries can happily accept that too. Incidentally, capacity is not controlled just by sheer height. You can also build outwards. You can have as many layers as you like as long as the lifting mechanism can reach that far. The point is that we can step away from fossil fuels now. Gasoline cars will go away by attrition, replaced by electric vehicles over time. Power plants burning coal, fuel oil, and natural gas can be supplemented by renewables as they shut down due to age. We simply won't replace them. Natural gas plants last 20 to 30 years, and most are halfway there already. The same can be said for petroleum fuel oil power plants, lasting 40 years, and coal-fired plants lasting 50 years. And many are approaching retirement age. Chemical batteries are expensive, have short lifespans, and are both expensive and difficult to recycle. We'll always need them for mobile applications like car batteries or remote locations. Gravity batteries are the clear winner in terms of cost, durability, reliability, well-understood engineering, and limited environmental impact. We can do what is needed right now at low cost, or we can wait until all our coastal towns are underwater. Which will you choose? Let me know in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, please check my other video on 5 emerging battery technologies that will change our world. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.